Okay, you should now see the first slide, correct?
Yes.
So what I would like to, this is a webinar in the Time to Lead series. And the point is here that based on the book, I've done a lot of thinking about leadership and about contemporary issues. And what I would today like to talk about is, we have this upcoming election. And it's going to be an important election. We are currently, you know, not doing so well. By the way, that is not only for America. There's a lot of other countries as well. And I would like to draw some lessons from two great leaders, Franklin Delano Roosevelt and Winston Churchill. But let's first take a step back and look at where we are currently. Now, this was a poll among Americans that 80% of Americans in this recent poll said that the country was out of control. Only 15% thought it was under control. And I would love to speak to those 15% because I don't know why they believe that. I wish it were true. But what we are talking about is a situation we are facing, the corona crisis here, which has killed nearly four times as many people as died in the entire Vietnam War. I mean, that is a lot. And that's only for America. We have had the worst racial relations and actually also protests since the hot summer of 1967. We have seen a severe economic recession and worsening relationships with China. Essentially, I think it is fair to say this is probably the worst year that we have experienced since World War II. My wife says that all the time, you know, this is the worst year in my life. And it is an annus horribilis, a horrible year. So in such a bad year that we are currently experiencing, it makes sense perhaps to kind of thinking about, okay, you know, is this so unprecedented? Well, the good thing is there have been other horrible periods in recent history in America and in other parts of the world, as we will see in a second. And we overcame those horrible periods as well. Now, periods which were very challenging. And what can we learn from history, from these previous leaders, what they do, and what does that inform us about the kind of leader that we would need now? And for that, I'm going to turn to FDR and Churchill. So how did they respond to the crisis that faced them? What were some elements of their leadership and what should we be looking for in our leaders? Now then, if we're thinking about today is not a good time, think about the Great Depression. Unemployment in America increased from a little above 5% in 1929 to 25% early 1933. And that without a social safety net. So these people were not doing well. At the same time, paralleling this, is that GDP in America completely imploded. A decline of over 25% in real GDP. So this is... And this was in America. In Germany, as some of you will know, it was even much worse. In England and France, it was bad, but not as bad as in the United States. But we are talking about a terrible situation. But these are cool economic figures. There was a real human tragedy underlying this. Look at here, a woman with two children in, it looks like something like a tent or so. This is not a war refugee. It's not a Syrian refugee. It is not a refugee in 1945. This is in peaceful America in 1932. Now, so this woman has lost everything. There we see a picture of a slum, people that were dispossessed, that had lost their homes, that could not pay the rent anymore, that has essentially lost everything, and they put up a slums there. And you know how what these slums were called? Hoovervilles. Hooverville, a city, but Hoover was the president at the time. They were called after the president because the president had essentially completely lost control over the country. And then at that moment, it is this famous saying, come is the hour, come is the man, or come is the person. Roosevelt was elected with a large majority in 1932. He took power in March 1933. And he took charge of the country, and a lot changed. But we are talking about now, when we're looking at how he took charge of the country, let us not forget that he took charge in a situation which was much worse than we are facing today. The first thing is that we can learn from his leadership is that people want their leaders to lead, not to follow, especially in tough times. Hoover had lost complete control. He didn't know what to do anymore. He had lost the ability to lead the country. The country felt it and became more and more despondent. What did Roosevelt do? The first 100 days after he was elected, 15 major acts were passed through Congress. Now, not all of those acts were equally effective. Some of them were, other ones were not as effective. But the country clearly got the message, there is now somebody in the White House who is doing something, who is pushing the country forward with some mistakes, because Roosevelt made his fair number of mistakes, but he did something and Hoover did nothing, was complete stalemate. So the country took courage from the fact that now there was a leader who took charge, regardless whether everything was equally effective. A second aspect is, think about it. When you are in a crisis, how do you feel? Depressed. You feel bewildered. You are fearful about my job, about my family, about my health in this case, etc. So you are fearful. You are bewildered even. What do you want your leader to be? Do you want your leader to be erratic, narcissistic, making it all about himself, emotional outbursts, or do you want your leader to be cool, rational, measured? Now, Roosevelt was in about any situation in control. He was very cool. He was very measured. He was very rational. He was essentially a beacon in these wild oceans. Now, he wasn't always like that, because Roosevelt was really like a golden boy. He had had no big disappointments in his life. He became assistant secretary of the Navy at a very tender age. And then in 1920, he became the vice presidential candidate on the Democratic ticket. Now, this was not the Democratic year, 1920, but wait a second. The guy was about 40 and he was already vice presidential candidate. So everything, and he came from a very wealthy family. So essentially everything looked good. And then disaster struck. He got polio. 1921, he got polio and the whole world collapsed. He had to struggle for more than 2 years to essentially get back a bit in the game, but he could never walk without crutches and he could never stand for a longer time. But he overcame it. Now, this was a blessing in disguise, because it learned Roosevelt more compassion for his fellow men, and it gave him also an inner resilience that before he lacked. It helped him prepare for the great crisis of 1933, so when he became president. And there he was able to feel with the people, but to guide the people. Now, what we see here is one of the best examples that was in his inaugural address. I will play a little bit of his inaugural address. I need to check. Tell me whether you can hear it well or not, because it runs from the computer, so you should be able to hear it well. You can't hear it? Okay, then I am going to stop sharing. And then I am going to share screen again. Yeah, that is it. Now you should be able to hear it.
Mr. Chief Justice, my friends, This is a day of national consecration. And I am certain that on this day, my fellow Americans expect that on my induction into the presidency, I will address them with a candor and a decision which the present situation of our people impels. This is preeminently the time to speak the truth and boldly, nor need we shrink from honestly facing conditions in our country today. This great nation will endure as it has endured, will revive and will prosper. So first of all, let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself, nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror, which paralyzes needed effort to convert retreat into advance.
Now, this is crucial. So many of us know it. The only thing we have to fear is fear itself. So do you see what the president was doing? He did not deny the fear. He knew that the people were fearful, but he tackled it head on. We have only to fear the fear. And he came up with the solution. But what he was doing at the time, he was electrifying the people because they were fearful. If Roosevelt said, you have nothing to worry about, it would not be believable. Roosevelt tackled it head on, but you listen to his voice. There is an authority in his voice, a command which reverberates through history. And that was the cool leader that America needed. Then there was another point, is that Americans intuitively understand that together they can accomplish a lot, if not everything. And that also would go for Indians, that would go for other countries, that people understand that an individual or a small group can accomplish very little, but together as a nation, America or a nation in general, can accomplish a lot more. So what Roosevelt did in all his speeches, he made it about us, not we versus them. He was talking a lot about let us sit together, you and I, to consider our pressing problems. So the point is, in his speeches, he was not talking only about I, but it was you and I, or us. And that gave Americans more of an idea that they could do it together. And we know that there is more polarization today than there have been for some time. I know that is, for example, the case in India, that is the case in the UK, that is certainly, unfortunately, also the case in the United States. Now, Roosevelt had one of the greatest challenges when he had to talk about us at the moment when the 30s were moving towards the end and the domestic crisis receded somewhat, but it was replaced by an international crisis of an even much greater danger, and that was the rise of Nazi Germany. Germany was incredibly powerful and it was highly aggressive. Its army was the best in the world and it was gobbling up and conquering one country after the other. So in the end of 1940, there was only one country standing, and that was Great Britain. Now, the problem was that Great Britain had to face Germany, which was industrially stronger and had conquered all those territories. So Great Britain had to import a lot of war material to make up the gap with Germany. Now, that makes sense. However, what was the country where there would be the industrial base? That was the United States. But the United States had the neutrality laws, which said that you were only allowed to get stuff, import stuff from the United States through cash and carry. That is, you had to pay cash, so you could not borrow money. You had to pay cash in dollars, and you had to carry it yourself. Now, carrying it yourself, that was no problem. The British merchant marine was huge. But dollars. Britain was running out of money. So the end of 1940, Prime Minister Churchill, whom we'll see in a moment, wrote to Roosevelt. He essentially said, Britain, we are running out of money. We cannot pay for it anymore. Can you not help us? Now, according to everybody, that letter made a great impression on Roosevelt. And he was thinking about it. And he came up with the idea of land lease. Land lease is the idea, was the idea that America would lend Britain war material, planes, tanks and guns and everything. And Britain would then give it back after the war, which of course was, everybody knew that after the war, you didn't need all those tanks anymore. And most of the tanks would have been destroyed anyway. But Roosevelt kind of thought out, okay, this might be a way to help Britain. But that had to be approved by Congress, because that would be essentially the neutrality laws would forbid that. So Roosevelt knew what had to be done. He wanted to help Britain, but the country and Congress were largely isolationist. He also knew that if America would come together, there would be something going on that could help. He couldn't do it by himself. And this is a little snippet from his world famous fireside chat in December 29, 1940, in which he proposed land lease to the American people. I will only have a little bit of it to give you not only his voice, but also how he is all the time talking about us. It is not his idea. It is not his wish. I said, we together as a nation can do this.
Tonight, in the presence of a world crisis, my mind goes back 8 years to a night in the midst of a domestic crisis. It was a time when the wheels of American industry were grinding to a full stop, when the whole banking system of our country had ceased to function. I well remember that while I sat in my study in the White House, preparing to talk with the people of the United States, I had before my eyes the picture of all those Americans with whom I was talking. I saw the workmen in the mills, the mines, the factories, the girl behind the counter, the small shopkeeper, the farmer doing his spring plowing, the widows and the old men wondering about their life savings. I tried to convey to the great mass of American people what the banking crisis meant to them in their daily lives. Tonight, I want to do the same thing with the same people in this new crisis which faces America. We met the issue of 1933 with courage and realism. We face this new crisis, this new threat to the security of our nation, with the same courage and realism.
So, do you see what he is doing? So, by studying great past leaders, you get a whole lot better insight into effective communication. So, for example, I quote from him, this is, we met this issue with courage. We faced this new crisis, the security to our nation. He also started out by harking back to that earlier crisis, 1933, the banking crisis. And he says, we met that crisis with courage and realism. Okay, now the president comes back to the people. Everybody remembers that. And the president says, at that time we did that. Why could we not do it again this time? So he used the authority that he got from the first time to essentially tell the Americans the second time, you know, why can you and I together not do it? So this unifying message had an incredible effect. Before his speech, 83% of the Americans saw no need to be involved with Europe at all. After the speech, 54% supported land lease. That doesn't mean that they wanted to send soldiers to Europe, but that was not the president's proposal. The president's proposal was land lease. 54% supported land lease. And by the time it was passed through Congress, there was a pressure on Congress to agree because 77% of people had now supported land lease. Now, land lease was of dramatic importance. If you look at just at the bottom here, this is just what was given to Britain. 35% in 1941, the land lease was approved in March, April 41. 35% of total war material deliveries were under land lease, so Britain did not have to pay for it. In 1942, that jumped to 83%. In 1943, 97% of total war material that was sent to Britain. And we are talking about billions upon billions, $7.4 billion. Now, those are 1943 billions of dollars. So we are talking about more like $100 billion or something like that in current dollars were sent to Britain. And that had a great effect. Now, this is a book that my father gave me in 1985. It was at that time the newest biography on FDR. My father lived in the Second World War. He lived there and he was liberated. He lived in Amsterdam. Now, this is what he writes in his dedication to me. I will translate it. First of all, you cannot read Dutch. And second of all, my father's handwriting is challenged. What does he write? He says, for our son, Jan Benedict, never forget what FDR has done for the freedom and liberty of the Netherlands, exclamation mark. So that is without land lease, he could not have written that. So we are talking about a leader here that in trying times, first the Great Depression, then the Second World War, where the overwhelming population of America did not want to get involved, he was able to lead the people with courage, realism, and a unifying message. Well, there were people against him, but he always made it about us. Now then, we are talking already about the Second World War, and then let's dial back for a second here. And talking about 1940. In May 1940, the overwhelmingly powerful German army attacked the Netherlands, where my parents were living as teenagers, Belgium, and mighty France. And at the same day that the German forces attacked, a new leader came to Downing Street. That was the great Winston Churchill. Now, he got a baptism of fire that nobody, not even Roosevelt, had encountered. Because within a mere 6 weeks, mighty France collapsed. And the English army was pushed back towards Dunkirk. And it was able to be evacuated. But Churchill himself was quite clear. He said, you know, Dunkirk is a human victory and a military tragedy. Because at that time, yes, 300,000 men were saved, but all war material was lost. The Britain didn't have a single tank in its home country anymore. There were only a few guns. So everything was lost. Essentially, if the Germans would invade Britain, there was nothing to stop them anymore. So Britain had lost everything, and it was standing against the wall against a mighty Germany. He had to lead in that situation. Then on the summer of 1940, over the skies of Britain, a fierce battle was raging between the Royal Air Force and the German Luftwaffe. The German Luftwaffe was twice as strong and was battle hardened. Now, so what you saw here is that every day over the skies of Britain, hurricanes and Spitfires were fighting it out with the German Luftwaffe. It was about 1,000 people, about on the fate of the world depended on about 1,000 people. So that led Churchill to say those immortal words, never in the history of human conflict have so many owed so much to so few. So Britain was standing against the wall, and Churchill had to rally the nation. Now you could say, well, you know, it's obvious, we're gonna fight. No, actually, some of you will be aware of the fact that powerful factions within Churchill's own conservative party wanted to strike a deal with Hitler. They thought everything is hopeless. Led by Foreign Secretary Lord Halifax, they wanted to have a peace treaty, throw Europe over to Nazi Germany, if we can save ourselves. That was not what Churchill was doing. What he was offering the nation was honesty and hope. He was honest about the great dangers that the nation was were facing, but he also offered hope that there would be, the crisis would not be forever. Honesty about where we are now, could have a little bit more of that, and hope of a future. I have a short clip here of his most famous speech, in my view, but I'm not going to use the original recording. I'm going to use the thing in the movie, which I believe the movie Darkest Hour, for about 2 minutes. Now, when you listen to these words, they cannot fail to touch you. Now, remember, we are talking about a man here who was standing against the wall, who had nowhere to go, where everybody in Europe was hoping, praying day and night that Britain would hold out. And Britain had only about 1,000 fighter planes left, no cannon, no tanks, no nothing. And he had to steal the resolve of the nation. Well, a little different challenge from us. Let's look at what the great man says in this movie version.
We shall fight in France. We shall fight on the seas and the oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. Yeah. We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. Yeah. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender! And if which I do not for a moment believe, this island or large part of it where we're subjugated and starving, then our empire beyond the seas, armed and guarded by the British fleet, would carry on the struggle until in God's good time, the new world, with all its power and might, steps forth to the rescue and the liberation of the old.
So look at the message of honesty. He is brutally honest of the fighting. The fighting was going on in the skies. The fighting would be, if the Germans would invade Britain, would be fighting on everywhere. The hope was a tough hope. We shall never surrender. But the real hope was, we shall continue until America will come and help us. So he was here. That was the hope, the only hope, because Britain was, Churchill was quite realistic. He knew that Britain alone could not defeat Germany. But he, in this speech, which I cannot watch without emotion, is that he was very honest about the challenges, but he offered hope for a future. And one small side note, which for you interesting, about the challenges that you had to face, and that is should be a source of inspiration for us of courage. Is what? Oh, and that is that actually you saw at some point a guy, you know, looking sour. That. Excuse me? Okay, and that was Neville Chamberlain, because a large portion of his own conservative party did not trust Churchill very much, but after this speech, everything changed. A final lesson from these two leaders is that even in a crisis, you have already to look forward to plan for the world after the crisis. Now, Churchill did that, and he kept... He was essentially, he put up with Charles de Gaulle, General de Gaulle, who was the leader of the so-called Free French. Those were essentially the illegal government, because the legal government was in France, the illegal government in London of the resistance, if you will. And he was an insufferable guy. And Roosevelt wanted nothing to do with him. He thought, you know, he was an idiot, a megalomaniac, et cetera, et cetera. But Churchill put up with him. And why was that? Not because he liked the goal so much, because he understood that after Germany were defeated, and actually at that point, when he put up with the goal, it wasn't at all obvious, but he said, if we can defeat Germany, it will be destroyed, Germany, and we need a strong and confident France in Europe for stability of Europe. So he put up with the goal in the midst of the crisis, because after the crisis, he would need a strong France. At Yalta, the conference in January 1945, he was pushing towards arrangement of post-war Europe, while Germany was still fighting with millions of men, to arrive at a world in which the Soviet Union would not give too much power. Unfortunately, Roosevelt was already so ill at the time that Roosevelt gave away more than in hindsight would have been good, and Churchill kept on pushing it. And after the Second World War, what happened is that in his famous 1946 speech, he was the first to say, okay, what we are seeing is an iron curtain being drawn across Europe between the East and the West. So he was all the time planning for what is going to be next. And that planning is as crucial today as it was then. Think about our current COVID crisis. People say, you know, it was completely unexpected, the crisis. You know, that's actually not true. All the epidemiologists had said it is not a matter of whether, but it is a matter when such a pandemic will strike us. So when essentially the virus jumps from an animal to a human. And yet we were completely unprepared. We were unprepared in India. We were unprepared in Europe. We were unprepared in the United States. There are going to be other crises, other pandemics, dirty bombs, growing tension with China. You know, we don't know what is going to go there. Other things that we don't really know yet. But I think Mohammed El-Aryan said it really well. Something that is significantly lacking right now. It is better to be prepared for events that never happen than to be unprepared for events that do. We were really unprepared for events that do happen. So better let us prepare. What are the leaders' vision for the future? What is the world going to be after the crisis? What is their vision, how the country should look like? And I do believe that these lessons are relevant for us today. Why? Because Churchill and Roosevelt were men of flesh and blood. They were not ideal types, you know, that you find in the academic literature of a person without any mistakes. They had the fair amount of mistakes, and Churchill made some serious mistakes, of which, you know, people in India, for example, are quite aware of. But they rose to the occasion. They faced challenges that were bigger than ours. They rose to the occasion, they rallied the people, and together they overcame these challenges. So when I then think about, and this is also what I myself am kind of evaluating the candidates on, to be honest, is, and I'm not going to, it's not going to be a political kind of thing, but I do evaluate it because the point is, these are the two candidates that are available. You may or may not like the options, but these are the options that are available. Is which candidate, I, in my view, does America need is the one who is able to lead, clearly be in charge, because the country needs it. We are in crisis. To do that in a cool and a measured, in a consistent manner. Consistency is very important. Don't we teach our own children, you know, to be consistent and to be a bit measured, to be a little rational, you know, not given to emotional outbursts all the time? Well, what we teach our children, you know, we definitely would want to see in our leaders. A leader that is able to unify the American populace to overcome the current crisis. I think there is some of a challenge here on every side, at leader that can really unify everybody, who is also honest and realistic about the challenges that we are currently facing. You know, people do not want to be taken for fools. Be honest and realistic with them, but also offer hope. That is missing so much. And that is not only in America. Just yesterday, I read about the country where I was born, the Netherlands, where the prime minister has no hope. He has no vision. It is just pathetic. And the people feel it. And the people are starting to drift. People want to be, you to be honest, but also want to give you hope. And also the leader who has the wisdom to look ahead, to plan for the catastrophes that hopefully will never materialize. Which of the leaders has a vision into the future, how America looks like, how India looks like, how China looks like, how the UK looks like, how the country essentially looks like? Well, if you are interested in my book, Time to Lead, I discuss a number of these leaders and the leadership lessons that we can draw from them. I've shown here what kind of leadership lessons, some of the leadership lessons we can draw, you know, for in our current crisis from two of these great leaders, but they are not the only great leaders. And in the book, I look at a lot more leaders and also how that can apply to you personally. So,